Thank you, Francis. It is a real pleasure to have you all here, and sorry for the little delay in getting going. As Francis noted, this is part of our celebration of our 150th anniversary. The Peabody Museum is one of the oldest university-based natural history museums in the country. And this talk is another in a series that kind of places this museum in the context of larger events that were going on around the country and around the world during the museum's history. As Francis also noted, this is going to be a somewhat unusual talk in that two people who have worked together on the ideas and the projects you're going to hear about are going to speak in turn. I'm going to introduce them in turn, Allie Logan and Michael Anderson. I'll start with Allie. So Allie is part of the Peabody family. She was class of 2007 here at Yale College. She was a major in history of science and medicine. During that time, she worked on her senior project based here at the museum, and otherwise, I'm sure she'll tell you something about her other connections here at the museum, but haunted this place while she was a student here and knows a great deal about it. And I can tell you that when I got this position, one of the early things I read was her thesis, and it really helped me, in part as we prepared the 150th anniversary exhibition. I also know that Richard Conniff, who wrote the wonderful book about the Peabody, has also consulted the thesis. So those of you who saw Richard speak, we're going to be hearing from a primary source here tonight. So after Allie left Yale, she went on to get a Master of Health Communications from Emerson College. While she was a student here, I mentioned she worked as a research assistant, then a public program developer, and she can tell us a little more about that. And today she's based up in Burlington, Vermont, and works as a senior strategist for HMC Advertising. It's a real pleasure to be able to welcome her here. I'll get down so you can hear from her. So let's welcome Allie Logan.
Hello. It's nice to be back. It's nice to see all your faces. Nice to be back in the great hall again. Thank you very much, David. Thank you, Richard and Eliza, for inviting me here today. And thank you for my family members for the encouragement. I have to warn you, I was an academic for somewhat of a brief period of time, and I don't do a lot of public speaking, so hopefully you'll bear with me in this storytelling session. So with that, I'm here to tell a story. Actually, I'm going to tell a collection of stories that, when they're aligned, they shed light on a truly unique side of the Peabody. It's a side of the Peabody I don't think is obvious to people who come in here. And it's something that I had the pleasure of uncovering when I was here, as David mentioned, as an undergraduate, and then continuing to stay here as a public programs coordinator. So I'm here today to explain and hopefully excite you all about the many reasons why the Peabody came to have such an impressive and interesting and important groundbreaking legacy. And that is in its the fact that it's a museum of ideas. And it was one of the first museums, if not the first museum in the country, to ever put on explicit exhibit the evolution of primates to humans. So this is a very important aspect of the Peabody's history. So what better way to tell stories other than to start with my own story? And thank you, David, for giving a nice intro to that. Currently, I work in healthcare. I work in healthcare marketing. I'm a strategist, and that's a fancy word for taking complex ideas, data, and research, breaking it down into components, and recompiling it into stories, into comprehensible information that aims to excite and interest and, most importantly, motivate the people that I'm focusing on, often low education and low SES groups, to be healthier. So that's what I do in my day job. And I believe that the love of translating complex ideas and complex information really began here at the Peabody. It was fostered by the Peabody in the work that I did as an undergrad, in the work that I did on my thesis, and also the work that I did as a postgraduate student in the public programs department. So going back to my undergrad experience, when I first started working here, I had the pleasure of being literally immersed in the depths of the basement of the Peabody and all of the fossils that live down there in vertebrate paleontology. I don't know if there's any representatives here from that team, but just really had so much fun getting to know fossils and paleontology, and of course our annual expedition out west, our fossil hunting trip, where I stumbled literally upon this Triceratops ulna, and at the time an unmentionable paleontologist who I was working with told me it was only a rock. Luckily, I was persistent and uncovered this great fossil. So from there, as David mentioned, I wrote my senior thesis on the Peabody. I got to know one of its other really important and impressive departments, its archive collection. And Barbara Narendra was, I think she's here, was just so important and gave me so much guidance in orienting myself to the archives and really being able to find those disparate parts of the story and distill them and put them together to create my senior thesis. And that's what I'm going to be talking about today. And lastly, I had the pleasure, after filling my requisite graduate experience requirements and stayed on, moving into the public education realm, working here in the halls, helping to design exhibits with my friend Michael and other great members of the staff, and also working on the audio tour, which I think is still in existence here. So such a great first-hand experience of what museums do and that art of translating complex ideas. So with that introduction, I have two timelines to present. And the first is the context. It's the contextual story. And I understand that you probably can't read anything that's on this slide, and I will do my very best to translate that to you. So this story involves the presentation of two timelines, as I mentioned. The first timeline really traces a set of events and trends that provide the contextual backdrop for the beginning of the Peabody and how it came into existence, how it was founded, how it evolved over the few decades that I was focusing on, and eventually how it came to be this museum of ideas. So here we go. So I'm looking at 1859. Many of us know that this was the date of the seminal publication by Charles Darwin. This was just so important to the field of evolution, and it's really important to the story of the Peabody, and that's because this was the first explanation or interpretation of evolution that had a very clear mechanism. It posited how things evolved and why, and this was natural selection. The other reason it's really important to this story is because this publication was really the first of its kind to present the idea of evolution devoid of any reference to God or the Bible's interpretation of mankind and his creation. So very important for that reason. A lot of other reasons it's very important, but this will impact the story of the Peabody, as we'll see moving forward. Also in the 1860s, we see, in response to not only Darwin, but other academics and researchers coming to embrace the idea of evolution, the rise of the fundamentalist movement to counter that development and progression of evolution education. So we see specifically in antebellum Deep South, just a movement of fundamentalism and creationists rising up against the idea of evolution. Also, in the 1860s, we see an interesting trend regarding museums themselves. In my thesis, I think I have a line that is something along the lines, if the Peabody existed in the 1860s, it would be a private collection, probably owned by a rich elite member of society who only showed the fruits of his collection to his friends and colleagues. At the time, before the 1860s, museums were a product of hobbying, of rich people collecting and buying fossils and putting them on display to select groups of society. Really, as David mentioned, academic institutions, including Yale and Columbia, saw the collections of artifacts and fossils coming out of the West, coming out from all over parts of the world, as an opportunity to start to put on exhibit these collections and use them as an education tool, as a teaching tool that anyone from society and the public had access to. They also started using these collections as fodder for their academic curricula, specifically geology and paleontology. So that's really behind the movement of how the Peabody came to be. In 1900s, we see the rise of textbooks adopting evolution into their content. Specifically, many textbooks reference Darwin and natural selection. We see this as a trend coming up into at the turn of the century. Down here, another 1860s note. I just have the mechanisms. It's kind of a note about evolution and its acceptance and adoption. Although evolution was a fact that really was uncontested in academic worlds at the time, the mechanism by which evolution came about or occurred was not in agreement. And a lot of researchers and academics have been quoted and referenced saying that they really are torn in the reconciliation of their scientific truths that they know to be true in the form of evolution with their own personal faith, you know, trying to reconcile the two. So there's a lot of turmoil in this area, not just in the Deep South, regarding the fundamentalist movement. 1917 is a significant year for the Peabody's history, as we'll see. This is the year when U.S. joins World War I, and Woodrow Wilson, President Wilson, and U.S. Congress vote to join the war against Germany. We'll see how that has a really important impact on the fate of the museum. And then we come to 1925, which is just such an important year, such an interesting year that really kind of presents an overlap of events that really contrast with each other, as we'll see. And in the contextual story, it's significant because I bring up the culmination of that fundamentalist tide of conservatism and anti-evolution sentiment kind of culminates in the passing of a state law in Tennessee called the Butler Act, which made it a crime for any teacher to teach anything other than the Bible's interpretation of evolution in public schools. So the law is passed in March of 1925, and then it's implemented and enacted in the famous Scopes Monkey Trial later in that year, July 1925, when they actually convict a young teacher for teaching Darwinian evolution to his students. So again, this is very interesting in its own right, but we'll see how this really impacts and aligns with the events and trends that occur related to the Peabody. And that's my next story. And I know this slide is very busy and a little bit hard to look at, so feel free not to look at it. I'll do my best to explain it. So juxtaposed to the contextual story, we see that the rise of the Peabody is intricate, it's at times dramatic, and really it tracks the founding and the evolution and the sequestering of the museum to ultimately its renaissance and rebirth as a museum of ideas. And if you can see this timeline, you'll see that the contextual timeline is at the top, it's faded out. The Peabody story is down here in the lower two-thirds of the slide, and they track up to the events that I just spoke about. So we're going to go back to 1866. This is the year that the funds were committed to establish the Peabody Museum. George Peabody, the great uncle of the renowned paleontologist O.C. Marsh, commits money to establish the first ever Yale Peabody Museum in its former home on Elm and High Streets. And from its founding, 1866 through 1899, O.C. Marsh oversees the museum in its form, in the former building, and really has passion to expand and grow the museum into a museum potentially of ideas. So he's going on expeditions, collecting more and more fossils and adding to his collection over time. I think many of the fossils in this room might be O.C. Marsh's fossils, but I look to experts to confirm that. Anyway, he's very much a huge contributor to the museum's fossil collections. Fortunately, he passes away in 1899 before this vision of an expanded and more robust, well laid out museum is achieved. But luckily, he has a very capable successor, Charles Schuchert, who is the director of the geology department at the time. In 1900, we're down here. He commits himself to the vision of O.C. Marsh. He is the one that dedicates himself to carry forward that goal to expand the museum and expand its collections. So really, we see from 1900 through 1925, but between 1900 and 1910, Schuchert and his team are committed to growing the museum, potentially moving it to a new location, and of course, securing the funds to make that possible. So in 1905, he's developing a proposal for this. In 1909, they reach a pretty significant success with Margaret Sage's donation of $650,000 to move the museum to a new property, its current property here on Whitney Ave. Unfortunately, this wasn't enough money to do it, but it really was a great step forward. That was 1909. And then we move to 1916, which is significant in the fact that for Yale's university, they had a great boon in the donation by Mrs. Stephen Harkness. We know that name, Harkness, for the tower and the dormitories associated with it. She committed a, quote, magnificent sum to erect dormitories, but it was in the exact location of, at that time, the current Peabody Museum. So nothing like a huge donation to be a catalyst for the moving of the museum and getting all of the fossils out of here. So that was great news. I like to call that a happy coincidence. I think the staff of the Peabody saw it that way. And coincidentally, because of that, Yale agreed to donate the final required funds to actually put this into action. However, we go back to the year that many of us know, 1917, when U.S. joined World War I. Because of that, the economy suffered great impact and construction costs skyrocketed. And as a result, Yale and other funders said that because of this, the Peabody Museum's relocation had to be indefinitely postponed. So up here, July 1917, although Yale commits the funds to help move the museum, they cannot do that at this point in time, and the staff literally must move all of the fossils out of the current building into storage in only 6 months. So this is just a great setback and a huge source of frustration for members of the Peabody team. So in between 1917 and we get to 1921, it's just kind of a dark era for the Peabody. All of the collections are in storage, sequestered away. Charles Schuchert, who is still the director, his personal correspondences reflect growing frustration and angst surrounding the delayed progression of O.C. Marsh's vision of this museum just being a robust and really kind of welcoming, well laid out place. So he is growing more and more frustrated with the process and the progress. And in 1921, luckily, museum planning is resumed, construction prices have come down, and Yale agrees to move forward with funding the relocation. However, at this point, Schuchert has had it. He's ready to retire as director and honestly ready to retire from Yale. In a letter to the president of Yale, offers his resignation, but in the same letter, he recommends that Richard Swan Lull assume directorship. And this is a very important figure in the history of the Peabody. Richard Swan Lull has a geology background, and he is a very prolific and important and accomplished vertebrate paleontologist. So he's very much involved with the Peabody at the time and has been helping Schuchert along the way and is a very obvious next director. So he's unanimously approved as the next director in 1922, and in 1923, ground is finally broken. This is 23 years after O.C. Marsh's death. So finally, 2 decades later, the new Peabody is coming to fruition. And it's coming to fruition under Lull's leadership, which is very significant. So moving to mid-1925, Lull, who, as I said before, is a professor of geology, he's very popular for his classes in evolution. He's known as a renowned, very accomplished evolutionist. He has not subscribed himself to one mechanism of evolution and how it came to be. So that really makes him unique because he does not espouse or pick one mechanism. He really his focus is presenting the fossil record as it is and allowing his public or his readers to come to their own conclusions about how evolution occurred, whether it involves God, whether it doesn't. So that's important, and along these lines, in 1925, he publishes a very seminal and popular book called Ways of Life. And this is important in the fact that he's one of the unique researchers to put out into his public that no mechanism of evolution is endorsed, but also it's directed at the lay person, and he uses that word in his preface. And not only that, he uses this book also in his preface to be a very loud counter voice to the fundamentalist tide that's brewing in kind of conflict the idea of evolution education. So this is happening in 1925. And the response to his book is universal success. Press love his book, press kind of call him the father of evolution outside of Darwin, and really look to him as an authority on the topic. And just a few months later, Lull oversees the dedication of the new museum, of which he has completely reworked the layout and design of the museum's floor plans. And this is significant because he does this, and he says this in his correspondences and his archives, to be a very clear and interactive testament to evolution. The layout and design of the floor plans, the layout and presentation of fossils are very much proof that evolution exists. And as we know, the Peabody, that's how these different rooms are positioned. We start with invertebrates, we move through the animal progression, and we come to the very important Hall of Man, which at the time, Lull oversaw the development and design of that, and the very iconic and focused exhibit right in the middle of the room, which shows primates evolving to human skeletons, which is just such an explicit and very obvious proof for his public that evolution exists and man is related to monkeys. So this was all Lull's brainchild, and this all came to a head in 1925. So going back to 1925, just for a second, I can't stress enough how important this year was at the time that I was researching this project. It was just really amazing feeling to find resources from all over the map about how everything was coming together at this time. I was reading newspaper articles, I was reading letters from Lull to the director of the American Museum of Natural History, and everything was really kind of focused in on the 1925 year when the Scopes trial was happening, the Butler Act is passed, Lull publishes his very important and public-facing text, Ways of Life. The Peabody is open to the public in a very overt testament to the proof of evolution. It is designed in that way to prove evolution. So come to the moral of the story. I've told a bunch of different stories here, but I really think the moral of the story is what's important. So after hearing the details of these stories, I think all of us can recognize that the Peabody has a very interesting, it has a complex, it has an at times dramatic and frustrating past. I'm sure that continues to be true today. But what I'd like to conclude with, again, is what can we take away from this story, and what can we learn to benefit our lives today and the work that museums do today? And in my opinion, that's that thanks to key players, key, very important and committed and dedicated figures, George Peabody, O.C. Marsh, Charles Schuchert, and of course, Richard Swan Lull, and plenty of other players who were important at the time, Peabody really created its own legacy. It really came into its own legacy by its strength and its perseverance. It endured setbacks and delays. It literally endured a fundamentalist movement trying to counteract and destroy everything it stood for. So, you know, talk about a commitment to projecting and progressing a scientific truth. So at the end of the day, what's important is this place was celebrated. This place was unanimously lauded when it opened again in 1926, and it was because of its dedication to the presentation of scientific truths and its commitment to taking those complex ideas like evolution, natural selection, mechanisms by which evolution happened, fossils, and translating them and breaking them down and making them interesting and accessible and exciting. And it did that for people of all levels, of all cultures, of all backgrounds, religious backgrounds, educational backgrounds. And I think that's what's really important here. And that is what the Peabody's legacy is, that it's a museum of ideas, and it's committed to progressing public education around often very controversial ideas. And that's what it continues to do today. And I think that's really important. And I think that is the biggest reason why I'm so excited to be here to help celebrate with the Peabody. Thank you.
So thanks very much, Allie. I think I speak on behalf of the job security of all the professors around here that we hope that you don't get any more public speaking experience. So now we're going to turn the microphone over to Michael Anderson, and I'll introduce Michael very briefly. The best way to describe Michael is he's the Peabody's Renaissance man. And when I give that answer, people just kind of look at me, what does that mean? And it really does mean, and what I tell people is he can do anything. Michael is a scholar. He has written extensively on the history of how we present nature to the public and some of the, everything from the techniques to the larger strategies. He paints, he draws, he sculpts, and he has dedicated his life and has been here for about 35 years. And much of what you see around here, including the Torosaurus out on Whitney Avenue, is a product of his hands and his mind. And so with that, I'm going to introduce Michael to carry this story forward. Let's welcome him.
All right. First, just a correction here. I've only worked at the Peabody for I'm on my 28th year, but I've worked in the museum field for 35 years, so it's not quite as... I'm not that old yet. Anyway, all right, I got some notes. Let's see. Get this going here. There we go. So I'm my presentation is about Albert E.D. Parr. And Albert E.D. Parr was director of the Peabody Museum from 1938 to 1942. So he followed after Lull. I'm not sure if there was another director in place there, but anyway, he's 1938 to 1942, and he went to the American Museum of Natural History in 1942 to become the director of the American Museum of Natural History, and he was director there for 17 years, And he had a huge impact on both institutions and on museum exhibitry around the country. So this is another picture of Parr as a young man. I found this on the web. I'd never seen it before. And I clicked on the website, and I was surprised to find the website is called Hot Men from the Past. And so Albert made the grade. He shares it with a lieutenant who lost his life at Little Bighorn, and Joseph Stalin. I didn't know that, so there you go. Anyway, Albert Parr, there are two ideas that I'm going to get across, try to get across here at the in this presentation, and they have to do with his exhibit philosophy. And Parr developed a exhibit philosophy that humans should be a priority in all exhibits and all displays in natural history museums. He was really not happy about some of the displays that he had seen, especially down at the American Museum, where they have halls of dioramas that show pristine environments with no human intervention, no human, any sense that there's any humans around. It's completely before humans, I guess. And so he really wanted to include humans in the mix. And the second part of this is that he also was critical of dioramas in general. And he felt that they were not really very good mediums to transfer educational information. So those two concepts I'm going to be talking about. So Albert Parr was born in Norway, in Bergen, in 1900, and he spent a lot of time at this museum. This is the Bergen Museum, and it's a natural history museum. He was influenced by the exhibits there, and he then went on to study at the University of Oslo, got his degree, and came back to this museum to be director of fisheries research. He was a fish guy. And so these are some of the exhibits that Parr was looking at. These happen to be in the Peabody archives in a file of Albert Parr. So Barbara Narendra has helped me find these. Anyway, these are the kind of exhibits at the Bergen Museum. And there were some mini dioramas, ethnographic displays, kind of the ubiquitous specimens on the wall type displays from the 19th century, specimens in jars, taxidermy animals, models. There's fish in the very background back there that Parr was interested in. And this one actually caught my eye because it actually shows what Parr was interested in this idea of human impact in the environment and whether this actually was something he saw and whether it actually helped develop his exhibit theories. I have no idea. But the idea that a domestic animal is prey to these animals, these hawks, are part of what Parr wanted to embed in his exhibits. So Parr moves to the United States in 1926. He meets this man. I got this portrait on the web also, and I can guarantee it didn't come from hot men from the past. This is Harry Payne Bingham. And they met at the New York Aquarium. Parr said that he was washing the floors, which I highly doubt. But anyway, Bingham and he became friends. And Bingham asked him to be curator of his extensive fish collection. So Parr agreed, since I don't think he had a job. And Bingham then gave his collection to Yale and started the Bingham Oceanographic Laboratory, which Parr then became director of. And so Parr, while he was director of the Oceanographic Laboratory, oversaw marine research and actually did some himself, where he explored the Caribbean, the Gulf of Mexico, and adjacent Atlantic waters. Parr rose through the academic ranks. He became professor of oceanography in 1938, and then also that same year, director of the Peabody Museum. So, car at the Peabody Museum. What we probably most remember Parr for is hiring this man to paint the mural. Actually, what Parr called it was a decoration. He wanted a decoration for the east wall of the Great Hall. And so he hired Rudy Zallinger, which I think Rudy Zallinger was a scientific illustrator for Parr. I think that was, anyway, here's Zallinger doing drawing his underdrawing for the fresco that would come. The other thing that Parr did was he moved the one of the anthropology exhibits from the third floor down to the first floor as part of the evolutionary sequence. So he extended the biology of man to include an anthropology exhibit on Native Americans, I believe, is what the subject was. So again, he's trying to enhance and trying to prioritize human and man's involvement with evolution and with all aspects of the museum. So again, he was working out these ideas, these exhibition ideas with some of the people at the museum, and specifically with Carl Dunbar and Stanley Ball. And he proposed a, So he proposed the Connecticut Diorama Hall and the Connecticut Hall of Archaeology on the third floor. He didn't write anything down, but he told Dunbar and Ball kind of extensive ideas about what he thought should be there. And so after Parr left and went to the American Museum, Carl Dunbar succeeded him as director, and he and Stanley Ball then created what we see on the third floor. It's changed some since they started working on it, but the three dioramas and the Connecticut Native American displays are all part of the hall as Parr envisioned it. So these, we know this diorama well, but this farmscape in the landscape is actually all Parr. I mean, that's Parr's ideas of including prioritizing human living in the landscape, working in the landscape, the cattle and the pastures in the background. And also, this is fairly new in terms of dioramas. Most of the dioramas were pristine habitats. So this is fairly new. This is one of the first that I know of where we actually get like a farmscape in a natural history diorama. Okay. And then the lighthouse at the point, that's more of it. The town of Stratford in the distance, Milford Point. Again, more the shell midden in the right-hand foreground, evidence of human use, historical use. This slide I included, I took it because I'm working on this right now. I'm actually working on the rehabbing these dioramas. And one of the things I'm working on is trying to reinvigorate some of these grasses that are kind of falling over, and gravity's taken its toll on these things. So I was talking to Patrick Sweeney in the botany division, and he identified these grasses as festuga grasses. And he said, you know, are you aware that this might actually be a path in here, this area right in here? He said, because the festuga grasses and the dandelions indicate that this is actually a path or disturbed habitat. So I discovered for myself one of Parr's embedded stories in here. Another one, you can't really see it, but that is a robin pulling a worm out of the ground. And I don't know if people know this, but it was a shock to me that earthworms, as we know them in the Northeast, are really not indigenous to this area. They came with the European settlers and their livestock, and as ballast in the ships. They all came from the Old World. So another story Parr has embedded right there in the front. So again, this is all Parr. The diorama hall the dioramas on one wall, and then on the facing wall we have the Connecticut Native American archaeology, their tool making industry and basketry, clothes, lifestyle. It's all par. So while he wasn't here, he had a big effect on in terms of creating and directing this exhibit. So I'm leaving the Peabody Museum. I'm going to follow part to the American Museum of Natural History. And so this is one of the kind of dioramas that he really was critical of. This is a beautiful diorama at the American Museum. It's the Greater Kudu, and it's just a gorgeous composition. It's a beautiful thing. Anyway, this is the kind of diorama that Parr would really like to just remove. Thank God he didn't. But the other part of this, now, this idea that I was talking about, that dioramas as educational as in terms of a way to transmit information. I want to read a quote about that aspect of it that Parr wrote. He said, "The educational method of the Habitat Group is indirect. It is one of the outstanding virtues of this form of presentation that it does not pre-digest the evidence. It makes a total reconstruction of a scene or event in nature in which the effects of many natural laws and scientific principles are implicit, and for which it is possible for a penetrating mind to draw many conclusions and gain many new insights." So that's the positive. That's where he's admitting that dioramas have power and they are effective in some ways. On the other hand, the Habitat Group also offers abundant opportunities for those not versed in scientific deduction to overlook or misunderstand the messages implicit in the exhibits. The label or the lecture has therefore always been an essential adjunct of the Habitat Group, relied upon in an exceptional degree to bring out all the lessons implicit in the exhibit. So he was critical of these as the ability to transmit educational information. He also thought they were expensive in terms of the time needed to create dioramas, the resources it took, the money, the space in the museum, and he felt that there might be better ways to produce produce exhibits in general. So that said, Parr created two exhibits while he was director of the American Museum, and one of them is a diorama from one of them. It's the North American Forestry Hall, and this is a beautiful diorama as well, painted by Francis Lee Jacques. And it's just a section of it. It's actually a surround diorama on three sides. If you haven't seen it, you should go see it. It's still on display. Parr, in this Hall of North American Forest, had 10 full-scale dioramas built. And I'm saying, wow, this is a contradiction. 8 of those were pristine environments, right? So what's that all about? It turns out that Parr thought that full-scale dioramas are very good mediums for depicting forest habitats, so he had them built. So Parr was an interesting guy. He wasn't, he didn't like stick to one kind of rigid way of thinking. He was quite a person, quite a intellect. So the second exhibit that Parr produced is the Warburg Memorial Hall of General Ecology. Sorry, I can't read. I got to read it right. But I call it the Warburg Hall. And it's similar to what we have on the third floor, except that it is focused on Dutchess County in New York, which is a local area around New York City, and an area that would be familiar to most people who visit the New York Natural History Museum. And this exhibit really was Parr's idea of a response to the halls of dioramas. And again, kind of ironically, it starts with a full-scale diorama. And this is Stissing Mountain, and It's similar to the shoreline diorama in the sense that there's a path in the foreground and some disrupted habitat in the distance, but basically there's no evidence of humans in this. So it's kind of interesting. Parr's idea, though, was that by going through the Warburg Hall, reading all the displays, and there was, from here on out, they're all didactic displays. And it's, and I'm going to show you some photographs of them, but by going through and studying all the didactic displays, a visitor could come back and see and understand the embedded stories in this diorama. That was his idea. So this hall is still in existence at the American Museum. It's in need of a serious cleaning and a serious upgrade. It's probably not going to last very much longer. You'll see from my photographs. This is one of the didactic displays on flower fertilization. This is a large, it's about 8 inches, 10 inches. It's an enlarged flower. This is Robert Kane. He was one of the diorama painters at the American Museum, and he's painting these small mini dioramas that Parr thought were more effective than the large scale ones. And you see all the this kind of plant germination. And this was rotation of farm crops. These show rotation of farm crops, and there's things in the foreground. So Parr's trying some different things. This is a, I'm not sure this is one of those mini, I don't think it is, but this is a forced perspective mini diorama. So I think the line of the three-dimensional to the two-dimensional goes right into here, and it's, anyway, they are interesting. And then we have things like this, which again is kind of like the Bergen displays, the mini habitat groups with a little painted study in the background. But these are very focused stories that he's trying to tell. And just an aside on this too, in the 1950s, they had some of the best foreground artists working ever. I mean, these guys had done all kinds of work with dioramas. And these lady slippers in the foreground, I walked through with one of the educators. He was retired, and he said, "You know, these models are so accurate. I can tell students how bees pollinate by going in one area of the orchid and coming out another, and the pollen is brushed on its back. You could see all that detail. You can't see it now, but anyway, that's the kind of quality. There's a lot of jewels here, a lot of diamonds in the rough." Gorgeous stuff. Parr innovated this thing called a mirroscope. So there's two little groups down below, and there's a mirror, and as you light one group, one shows up, and as you light another, it goes in between. So these were some of Parr's innovative ideas. They look pretty shabby. And a lot of labels, a lot of reading in this. This is hard to see, but it's there's a dead animal in the front here, and they have all the things feeding on it. It's really gross. And this is the label for it. And just, I really put this in just to show how much text there is. And then also, there's, this is all insect frass. So there's a lot of bug debris and just, it's really disgusting. Anyway, it's not gonna last very long. The Warburg Hall really is an illustrated textbook, and it never really succeeded in engaging the audience like the diorama halls did. So Parr, it never really worked in terms of an exhibit that way. But Parr wrote very persuasively about his ideas, and he was very involved with the American Association of Museums. And every issue of Curator magazine, there was always a Parr article from the 1950s to the 1970s. So he had this, and they were all about exhibits. So he had a great impact on exhibit building across the nation. So with that, I'm going to just mention one other person. Harold Anthony was the mammalogist at the American Museum in charge of the couple of diorama halls, the African Hall and the North American Mammals. And in 1942, this was the same year Parr comes to the American Museum, Harold Anthony opened the North American Mammal Hall. There were 10 dioramas. They're now, I think there are about 40. But at that time, they opened a portion of it. And I want to read some of his quotes that were given at that opening. And they really are, to me, in response to Albert Parr's ideas of exhibit making, in some sense. So here's Harold Anthony. He said, "The new hall is more than the Hall of North American Mammals. It is a hall of North American geography in a broad sense, and a hall of North American ecology, with botany and all of the other environmental factors receiving the utmost attention. In the mountain lion diorama, which is up on the wall, sited in the Grand Canyon, the casual visitor views the background in terms of enjoyment and entertainment, but the geologist sees in a marvelous example of stratigraphy and of erosion on a stupendous scale. A student of botany or ecology sees other things. He sees the flower, known as the cliff rose, growing out of the rock in the foreground, the cactus near at hand, the arid aspects of the landscape, and the lack of any vegetation on many of the slopes, demonstrating that erosion of the land proceeds unabated when there is no ground cover to check it." This is the Wapiti diorama, or the elk, at the American Museum. Anthony saw the dioramas as places to rest from the war-mad world. Remember, it's 1942. With daily press and radio continually impressing one with man's destructive powers. He saw that the dioramas as an art form can hold out hope and provide spiritual sustenance. In the dioramas, the sun still shines, the plants and trees are still green or budded with promise, and the animal life is still pursuing the same patterns of life as in times of peace. To preserve the contemplative quality, he felt that labels must be restricted to a size and prominence that will not compete with the group itself and act as a distracting influence on the hall, in the hall. The beauty and the illusion of reality are lost if large, conspicuous labels catch the eye at every turn. He went on to say, "If exhibits are openly displayed as lessons, many visitors will turn aside because they are not in the mood." Prophetic for the Warburg Hall 10 years later. "The education and inspiration in the dioramas is there for those who seek them and who can slow down and quietly observe what is there. For in these exhibits, the visitor finds tongues in trees, books in running brooks, and sermons in the stones." Quite poetic for a mammalogist, I'd say. I don't know, Dorcas can help you. Anyway, in conclusion, I just want to say that bringing you up to date, to modern day, that Parr's exhibit ideas won the day, and that the diorama production pretty much ceased in the 1960s. It certainly did here at the Peabody in 1962. And we're now in the age of diorama restoration, which I like to like to be part of that. The Warburg Hall, as an exhibit, was a failure. But Parr was actually right that exhibits with content like the Warburg Hall is more critical than ever. The need to find creative solutions to getting that information out to the public is ever more critical with some of the environmental conditions we're facing today. Museums adopted Parr's ideas and relied, brought it up to date with videos, computer animation, games, interactive displays, and anyway, that helps to transmit these ideas. It's much more engaging and actually fits a lot of the public who's electronically focused. On the other hand, Parr's critique also is partially correct about the dioramas as being imperfect in an effective way to transmit educational information. But what they do offer is a combination of intellectual stimulation and emotional engagement. There's a new area of academic research going on called contemplative pedagogy. Seriously. And dioramas actually could fit well into that curriculum because dioramas offer contemplative engagement. When one stands in front of the diorama and looks at what is in front of them, breathing slows, heart rate drops, And I actually want to propose that we make a sign that says, this is a cell phone free environment. Information received when with that kind of openness is remembered deeply, we never forget it. So this type of engagement goes beyond the information transfer that Par was talking about and gets to why we care about the environment. So ultimately, the Par style exhibits and the dioramas both have places in a modern exhibit, in a modern exhibitry. And Peabody demonstrates both of those, and I'm actually very grateful to be part of this museum for that reason. Thank you.